Greetings everyone. Well, I'm awake again, and as promised, after I shower and eat something, I shall tell you all another story. This is the story of how Thragma braved the elemental planes, two of the nine hells, and the entire astral plane to find Eurist Medbird, and how their friendship and sheer manliness allowed them to reside in the heroic domains of Asgard for all. Hey, sorry about the wait guys, I like to take long showers and I couldn't find the eggs. So, a bit more backstory to put this tale in context. I'm a year or more younger than the rest of my friends, meaning that I'm a grade below them. As such, when my senior year came around, which is when this game takes place, most of them went off to college out of state. The DM went to an in-state school, and I was already out of college at the time. He was 3 grades ahead of my friends, so I ended up spending a lot of time with them my senior year. So one day, the DM calls me up. Me, hello? DM, hey, anonymous. You doing anything tomorrow night? Me, eh, I've got work until 6, but after that I'll be free. What's up? DM me and I want to run another game, just the three of us. See how it turns out. I'd be DMing. Me, yeah, sure. Sounds good to me. DM, great. Bring your dice, Thragma's character sheet, and some snacks and drinks to my place tomorrow around 7. Me, alright. See you there. I'm prepared for another great game with my friends, but I'm pretty unprepared for what I see when I get there. The DM had a pretty crazy setup going on. He had taken one of those poster boards that fold in the middle, decorated it with a picture of the astral wheel on both sides, and placed it in the middle of the large table that was in his basement. There were 3 chairs set up, 2 across from each other and 1 on the other side, perpendicular to the 2 chairs. The poster board divided the table in half widthwise, making 2 separate gaming areas. I had a vague notion of what he was going to do with the setup, and after a brief explanation, I was right. Since Thragma was currently on the material plane, mourning his good friend Eurist, and Eurist was currently floating through the astral plane, mourning over the loss of his legendary collection of ales and other liquor, there was no way we'd know what was happening to the other. As such, the DM set up this screen to prevent metagaming. Now, you might say, but you can still hear what's going on over the side, to which I tell you, he had noise-canceling headphones for the both of us to wear. Thus began the campaign. I was the first to go. He turned the board slightly, as to make a larger area for the two of us, and we discussed what I was going to be doing. I had, despite my lacking intellect, deduced that Eurist was not actually dead, but in fact had been sucked through a portal to the astral plane, and as such could ostensibly be saved. So, after burning a good portion of my reward on research, companions, and expeditions, the DM informed me that I had finally located a portal to the astral plane. Armed to the teeth with the magical weapons and armor that I had accumulated over the course of the last game, I bid farewell to the underlings that I had hired to help me in my quest, telling them that if I did not return, then I had either been successful in my quest, or had died horribly to some monstrosity beyond the realms of man. They wished me well, and I stepped through the portal. Being a barbarian has its downsides, one of them being that you either have to hire someone to read things to you, or try and puzzle through multitudes of arcane tomes in order to find what you're looking for. I chose the former, and paid for it dearly. The DM informed me that I had made a mistake in my translation of one of the books, which led me wildly astray as to the portal I had entered. Turns out, I ended up on the elemental plane of air. Thragma was irritated, since that meant he would not be able to find Eurist immediately, and it also meant that he actually hadn't taught himself to read properly. And with that, the DM turned to T, and his turn began. I found out afterwards that, during his first turn, Eurist figured out how to make himself fly about the astral plane, fought some Jathianki mine pirates, and encountered a great Wimbronze dragon, who taught him about the astral plane, and informed him about the portals which were scattered about the plane that led to various parts of the cosmology. After waiting through T's turn, the order passed back to me. DM, after stepping through the portal, you find yourself floating in the middle of an empty expanse of sky. The only landmark you can see is the portal behind you, which then vanishes. Me, Thragma's flying? DM, yes. I grin the shittiest grin I can muster. Me, he has. Thragma is master of sky. Thragma makes sky rue the day it make Thragma go to wrong place and not find Eurist. DM, well, you have to think to make yourself fly here. With that, I drew my greatsword and told the DM that I wasn't using my intellect to move, but rather my deep-seated and incurable rage that fuels my every action. He stares at me, then shrugs. All right, I guess I'll allow it. Anger is a projection of will anyways. To speed this story up, basically what happened after that was Thragma used his anger to make himself a rocket. After hours of searching, he managed to locate the castle of a djinn, floating on a magical island suspended in the sky. DM, the djinn and his court look upon you with great disdain. Why do you come before us, mortal? This is no place for your kind. Mayhaps you should take your leave, lest you find yourself in more trouble than you could possibly imagine. Me no. Thragma needs your help, magic floating man. Thragma must find Eurist. DM, the djinn looks at you in confusion. Who is this Eurist? I recount the epic tale of my party in my own simple way, and the DM tells me that at the end of it, the entire court has tears dribbling down their faces. The djinn wipes a tear from his eye. Dot. We have never heard such a tale of heroism and friendship. We shall help you, whatever you need. Dot. My turn ends with the djinn allowing me the usage of one of his guest suites, and him giving me his sworn word that he would help me find my friend. Of course, taking the sworn word of a djinn at face value is a mistake which many an adventurer makes in his lifetime. The turn passes back to T, and he spends another turn flying around the astral plane trying to locate a portal to the material plane, eventually finding one that looks like it might be the right one. Of course, without a spellcraft check, there was no way to know for sure, so Eurist decided he would fly through the portal anyways and take whatever might come his way. That turned out to be a bad idea. The portal deposited him in the middle of the second ring of the nine hells, in a place known as the Infernal Court. Rather than simply tear him apart, though, the devils decided that they'd capture Eurist, keep him as their pet to torment for their entertainment, and then when his will was broken and he couldn't do any more, then they'd tear him apart. Of course, Thragma would have none of that. The djinn tells me that, through clever magical dickery and a properly aligned crystal ball, he's managed to locate my friend. To the best of his knowledge, he's in one of the nine hells, but can't really tell which one. I roll my eyes, asking the DM if he could possibly narrow it down. Thragma doesn't have an issue cleaving through thousands of devils and their minions to locate, but he would like to know how many thousands he'll have to face off against. The djinn tries his best, but can only narrow it down to the upper few levels. Pinpointing him without a sample of his essence is beyond his power. Being a lesser djinn, he is, however, able to open a portal to the astral plane's dimensional waiting room, which allows easy travel between the planes. The djinn tells Thragma to take the door, which is forged from black iron, and hands him a small silver coin which will afford him some protection from fire and from evil elegant creatures. He wishes Thragma well, and opens the door between the planes. After taking a quick ethereal jaunt through time and space, I touch down in the waiting room, which is actually just that, a moderately sized room, full of couches, with doors aplenty leading to the various parts of the cosmology. Mercifully, I pass the test to remember which door to go through and swinging it open dramatically, step through into the nine hells of Baeta. DM, you stand atop a pillar of salt, narrow stairs winding down around it to the ground. Flames lick at the sky, screams of pure agony fill the air, and as far as you can see lesser devils torment damned souls with pitchforks and sawtoothed glaives. A great cry goes up when they see you, and a horde of winged imps flies at you with malicious intent. Roll for initiative. My DM is great at streamlining larger scale combat, and as such my battle with the lesser devils took only about 10 or 15 minutes, with me cleaving through 9 or 10 of the imps per round. When it was all over, I stood victorious, with only about 50 of my whopping 468 horsepower missing. I kept one of the lieutenants alive long enough to interrogate him, gleaning that he and his compatriots had heard whispers that some of the lesser nobility of the second ring had recently acquired a new mortal plaything, with a will of iron and a backbone of steel. He tells me of the portal to the second ring, and when he also tells me that I will most likely die trying to take my friend back from the nobility, punch his brain through his face in anger. I cleave and smash my way through more hordes of lesser devils on my way to the portal, each one telling me the same thing, that there was no way I could save my friend, that I would die in the nine hells, and each time I punched their face in, After cutting them all down, I finally reached the portal, and repeated the process again until I reached the lair of the demonic nobility that had my friend. To make a long story short, most of the nobility never stood a damn chance. The silver coin that the djinn gave me a nice damage reduction against their spell-like abilities, and my strength modifier was so high at this point that, coupled with the large Azai's great sword I wielded with the help of Monkey's Grip and the legendary Cleave Feet, I was cutting through crowds of the abhorrent gentry like they were level 1 commoners. Finally, I stood before the pit fiend who presided over the court, his hands wrapped around the spiked chain that was clamped around Eurist's neck. His glorious beard was gone, shaved off by the devils, and all along his arms and upper body pulsing, evil tattoos had been inscribed. The light had gone out of his eyes, and he looked a different dwarf. DM the pit fiend laughs, and says mockingly, "Do you like what my devils have done with your friend? We find him much more obsequious." Me, I fly into a rage, attacking the pit fiend. Thragma don't know what that means. After a solid half an hour of combat, during which my health is knocked dangerously low, I finally managed to subdue the pit fiend. He lay on the ground in front of me, looking up with an almost pitiable look in his eyes. "DM Mercy, please. I can grant you unimaginable powers, untold riches. You can have anything your heart desires. Just don't kill me." Mithragma looks down at the form of the pit fiend, then raises his great sword above his head to strike the final fatal blow. Thragma just want his friend back. I brought the great sword down, piercing the devil's heart, and his hideous death scream echoed through the blood-stained halls of his decimated court. I leaped forward, encircling Eurist in my arms to protect him from the blast that follows his death, and after the flames subside, cradle him with tears in my eyes. The DM takes down the screen, and for the first time all game T and I look at each other. We reach across the table and shake hands. T Eurist mumbles something unintelligible to Thragma. Me, I lean in, trying to catch what he's saying. "What did you say? You shouldn't talk, you're exhausted." T Eurist puts his face right up to your ear, so he can whisper, "If ye have a drink, by the gods, give it to me." Me, I laugh heartily, reach in my pack, and give him the masterwork wineskin Eurist gave to me after our first big job together. He slurps the booze down eagerly, and I put him on my back, carrying him to the portal. We manage to get back to the waiting room without much trouble, and look about us. We can tell which door leads back to the material plane, but another door catches our eye. It's majestic, carved out of solid oak, steel studded with a motif of crossed swords embossed into it with inhuman skill. I look over my shoulder at Eurist, who shrugs. "It looks to be a bit more interesting than the other one." I take the knob, and walk through the door. At first, we think we've simply ended up back on the material plane. It all seems pretty familiar, but after a bit of walking, we notice we feel less tired, and Eurist can even hobble along of his own power. The colors are brighter and more bold, and much to Eurist's delight, the wineskin seems to refill itself. After about 2 hours walk, we end up at a great festival, with huge tents of all sorts of colors set up, the sounds of ringing metal, bawdy jokes, and shouts filling the air, and humanoids of all shapes and sizes walking around enjoying the fair. We gape, apenmuthed, at this warrior's paradise we've stumbled into, until a towering man in a horned helm wearing a masterfully crafted set of armor carrying a battle axe notices us. "Ho there, lads. It's not often we see new faces here in Asgard. What might your names be?" After introducing ourselves, and explaining our situation, the man sends for a litter to carry Eurist to what he calls the hero's bath. He takes me into a pavilion, which is filled with feasting men and women dressed in all sorts of clothing, and bids them be silent. He seats himself in a massive throne, and tells me to recount my tale. After my second retelling, the entire pavilion is silent for a few minutes, digesting the story. Suddenly, it explodes into furious applause, drunken cheering, and outright sobs of joy. Men clap me on the back and shove drinks into my hands. Women come up to me and kiss me. Poets offer their services to record my tale, and blacksmiths beg me to smith the finest new equipment so I might try my skill in the tonners. Cord himself raises me up to a seat at the head of the table by his right hand. But just as suddenly as it all began, a hush falls over the throng. I look about the pavilion for the source, and see it immediately. Eurist stands at the entrance to the pavilion, tall and proud, restored to his former dwarven glory. His beard is back, as thick and luxurious as I remember, and he's clad in the finest furs and armors that the legendary craftsman of Isgard can produce. I stride over to him, and raise him up on my shoulder, as the pavilion once again explodes into thunderous applause. And so our campaign drew to a close. Eurist and Thragma lived out their days in the lap of warriors' luxury, feasting, wenching, and fighting, going undefeated for as long as they live. It was an epic ending to an epic campaign, one that satisfied all parties involved. I rank it as my number one campaign ever played, and I reuse Thragma on a regular basis. I hope you all enjoyed my story. Stay classy, TG. If you haven't already, check out my Redbubble portfolio. You might just find something you like.
This is not okay. This needs to stop now. This is cancer. This is so much cancer that I can feel the tumors growing on my back. And it's way down heavy on me, and it's not okay. Can you help a nigga out and just stop this? Please?